typically it's seen at the age of 18 and 45. And morphologically, you can probably describe it as a retroperitoneuritis or papillitis, depending on the appearance of the nerve. Now, if you go into the causes of optic neuritis, there are numerous causes, of which the demyelinating are the most important variety that we normally deal with. The other is the infectious and the para-infectious causes. And you can have various other causes which also need to be investigated, and it's an atypical variety. Though most of the time it appears that the cases are of an idiopathic nature. Optic neuritis is seen in about 50% of patients with MS, and it's a presenting feature in about 20%. And recurrent optic neuritis is more common than MS, involving the same or the fellow eye. Now, the clinical features, as I said, females predominantly between the age of 20 to 50. It can also affect children and also can be seen in cases beyond 50 years of age. And it's more said to be common in the white population. The clinical features typically are uniocular and acute and often painful visual loss, which ranges over hours to days. And there could be mild cases with just 20/20 vision also. And visual loss may be very subtle to complete, and the peak visual loss usually occurs within 2 weeks, and after that it starts improving. And color vision and contrast sensitivity are also affected, and this is a good parameter for finding out whether the other eye is involved. Clinical features are the presence of an RAPD, and you can see that the fundus is showing a papillitis or a retrobulbar neuritis. It will be normal in a retrobulbar neuritis, and papillitis it will show a mild edema. Now, what is an atypical optic neuritis is when you see a painless visual loss, older patients with bilaterality, severe disc edema, hemorrhages and cortical spots seen, progression of visual loss beyond 2 weeks, and a failure to improve on treatment. And patients with atypical optic neuritis are at a lower risk of developing multiple sclerosis. So essentially, the clinical diagnosis remains clinical. It's based on the visual acuity, fundus, the pupil, color vision, and visual fields. But other tests are done more for follow-up and for finding out whether the fellow eye involvement is there. Those are the contrast sensitivity, the visual fields, the visual evoked responses, and the OCT. The other systemic investigations are required when it's an atypical. In most of the typical cases, you do not require any of these other investigations. But if you're looking for an infective cause, then you have to rule it out by various tests. CSF analysis is also a supplementary support for telling you about whether to support for your diagnosis of MS. But in generally speaking, it is really not required routinely. Then other tests, if you're thinking of toxic optic neuropathy or to rule out NMO, you have to, genetic analysis for LHON, etc. Role of MRI, it needs to be emphasized that it's absolutely required in every case of optic neuritis at the outset. And it also helps in ruling out if it's a retrobulbar neuritis, rule out compressive lesions, and also it helps in prognostication and deciding whether interferon therapy is required. And T2 weighted flare is what needs to be done with gadolinium contrast. And MRI spine is done if the MRI of the brain is normal. Then if you have more than 2 white matter lesions which are measuring more than 3 millimeters, this is typical of MS. Then it is mandatory also in recurrent optic neuritis, knowing about the long-term prognosis and in atypical cases, and especially in acute optic neuritis in children. Now, abnormal MRI scans are seen in 96% with a definite MS, 70% with a diagnosis of probable MS, and in 30 to 50% with a possible MS. Some other diagnostic tests are the, we have already mentioned on the importance of OCT, I can skip over that. Then we have done FMMRI in cases of, because you see in optic neuritis you find that the vision improves even in spite of the demyelination. So FMRI showed that the first picture shows a normal bilateral stimulation. But in case of a right optic neuritis, you find that the opposite cortex is showing a stimulation, and extra ipsilateral extracortical areas also are showing stimulation. So this is what is probably contributing to the early recovery of visual recovery. And later on recovery, you find that there is an incomplete the bilateral occipital cortical stimulation. As far as treatment is concerned, for the early visual recovery, IV methylprednisolone is, so you're all familiar with, should be given. It has no role in, affecting the multiple sclerosis process as such, but it only hastens the recovery of vision. Oral steroids are absolutely contraindicated in the standard doses. So at the RP center, we were using IV dexamethasone 200 milligrams into 50 ml and 55% dextrose, which is equally effective as the methylprednisolone. You're familiar with the OMTT. We probably will not go into details of it, but 457 patients were evaluated with three groups: placebo, oral steroids, and IV methylprednisolone. And a 15-year follow-up showed that there's a cumulative probability of developing MS by 15 years after the onset of optic neuritis, which was 50%. And the most important predictor was the white matter lesion at baseline. Even though there's no lesion, 25% chances of MS. And if there's one lesion, the chances increases to 72%. And they found that the male sex, disc swelling, severe visual loss are all associated with a low risk of MS. Then overall 72%, and as far as visual acuity was concerned, they had a very good recovery of visual acuity of 20/20 or better in 72%. But all these findings are in quite in contrast with our own findings, which I will let you know. The low risk factors which they described was there's no light perception, if there's a severe disc edema, hemorrhages, retinal exudates, and absence of periocular pain and male genital. Optic neuritis in Asia, there's a higher incidence of optic nerve head, that is a papillitis presentation. Bilateral cases are commonly seen. Pain, there can be painlessness, and visual outcome is little poorer than the ONTT, and the less amount of brain abnormalities are seen in the form of lesions. And association with MS is less commonly seen. So this is the results of 99 eyes which we studied at RP Center, and we found that vision of 6/12 or better was seen in about 64%, which is much less than the ONTT. And if you compare the other Asian countries, you find that there's a comparison, very good comparison with our Indian population, and quite in contrast with the ONTT in all factors, in terms of pain, in terms of bilaterality, in terms of association with MS. And the association with MS was seen more often with the RBN rather than the papillitis. So MS in Asia, 40% of patients present as a spinal form of MS, in which there is a higher incidence of visual impairment and a poorer visual recovery. And NMO antibodies are positive in about 10% of cases. And neuromyelitis optica is another entity which we won't go into at the moment, but zero positivity for NMO with the anti-aquaporin 4 is seen. The treatment, of course, for neuromyelitis optica is different from that of optic neuritis related to MS. Then the role of immunomodulators. Interferons are used. The most common ones are the interferon beta-1A, interferon beta-1B, and the other, Novatron and Copaxone. And these are used if there is any evidence of MRI lesions. The recommendations now, I would say, would be that if any case of OM optic neuritis comes, you should do an MRI. If there are any signs related to the spinal cord involvement, or if MRI of the brain is normal, then a spinal MRI is called for. Additional investigations like LP may be done. And so if you see a clinically isolated syndrome, which includes an optic neuritis, do an MRI. If there's a normal, if it's a normal MRI, then you can repeat the MRI after 3 to 6 months. If that is abnormal, then patient may be considered for treatment with interferons. If it is normal, then you can do a further screening. No further screening is required if there's any absence of symptoms. On the other hand, if you find that there's an abnormal MRI at the outset, The risk of MS is about 60%, and you should consider the use of